I mentioned briefly this morning Dr. Myron Tribus, who just turned 94, and he would have been here today for sure, but about 10 years ago he started getting severe dementia, but he was one of my mentors and coaches, and he was like best friends with Deming, and so I'd often go to Myron's house in California, and we would sit and discuss theory and discuss the application and what was going on, and then all of a sudden Myron would say, let's call Ed. I'm thinking, Ed who? He was talking about Edwards Deming. So he's the only person I ever knew that called him Ed. You know, the rest of us called him God. So, but Myron had a phrase that he just kept repeating to me over and over and over. And he says, leadership belongs to those that seize the initiative. You know, we tend to think leadership belongs to formal position, but only if you're seizing the initiative to actually lead, you know. And I think the last presentation is a really good example. Students can be leading and administrators just basically following and working through that. So that leads us into the next presentation with Jake Rodgers and Phyllis Tubbs. I often have people that just will call our office and just say, help us. we are stuck and we don't know where to go from here, and we've tried all kinds of those things. And so I often say we preach to the choir and then we work with the volunteers. So anytime somebody calls and they just say, you know, help us, Deming said over and over, help comes from the outside and by invitation. You first have to know that you need help and you want to do something. And then you have very willing learners to try to start that process. So Jake Rodgers was a fifth grade teacher. He just called up out of the blue and said, yeah, I found your website, and can you help us? Here's some of the stuff we've been doing. So I started helping him. He started applying stuff in his classroom. Before long, he had his partner, fifth grade teacher, working. Then it wasn't very long. They asked me to come and work with the elementary school. And then pretty soon, we're doing a four-day conference. We did a couple of them with your elementary school. And then he decided, hey, I want to make a bigger impact. So he went on to get his administrative degree, and now he's a principal at another school. So I asked him to bring some of his teachers, some things, and just to talk about, you know, when you come into a new system and you come into a new school, how do you begin that journey? What are some of the reflections, the things you found moving through that? So, Jake Rodgers.
Is this on? Hello. Thanks, David. So, like David said, I was asked to share about my experience applying Deming's thinking as a teacher and then also now as an administrator. Before I jump into that, I wanted to give you a little bit of background about myself. I originally went to school to become a teacher, and then after 4 years of working at a Boys and Girls Club and taking my first education class in my senior year, I decided I wanted nothing to do with working with kids. And so I moved to Lake Tahoe, and I skied and drove buses for a couple years. And then I missed Seattle, so I came back, and I still wasn't sure what I wanted to do. So I became a bartender. And anybody been a bartender before in here? So I don't, anybody, and then anybody been an educator after being a bartender? So you probably know it's great experience for working with kids and adults. So I got into teaching, spent 4 years as a Title I math and reading interventionist, and then spent 4 years as a fifth grade teacher. And then I'm in my third year as a principal at Gold Bar Elementary, which is about an hour east of Seattle. Personally, my wife and I, we live just in North Seattle, that's Sarah, and my daughter Emmy Lou, who's just starting to drive. Don't worry, she'll be two in December, so it's fine. This conference isn't really about me, but so you're probably wondering, why am I sharing so much personal information? And the reason is I'm going to tell you some stories and some feedback that I've received over the last few years that might make you think that my life revolves around flowcharts and run charts. And that's mostly not true. My wife might argue otherwise, but when I first was introduced to Deming's thinking, like David said, I called him up We had a, when I was a Title I teacher, we had just started a new support model where we were taking ELL services, Title I services, special education services, and we were pulling everybody together and kind of flooding into a grade level all at one time. And one of the unique components to it was that we had built into the schedule an opportunity to collaborate with every grade level every week. So we had 30 minutes every Friday to work with the team, to look at data, and to make adjustments for the next week. So we started that in 2006, and the results of that were, we saw some student learning, but we also, on those Fridays when we were meeting, we saw a lot of this. I kid you not, there were tears, there was yelling, it was fairly dysfunctional. And this was a group of people that really were close. They were friends, people hung out outside of work, but we struggled to work together. And this wasn't a school where there was traditionally a collaborative culture, and so we were introducing something new, and we didn't really know how to do that. So I went to my principal and I said, hey, you know, we've got this good system, we've got good curriculum, we've got really smart people, but we don't know how to work together. And he said, if you can find something, I'll pay for it, which is rare in education. And so I called our curriculum and instruction director, and she said, hey, I went to this conference a few years ago, and this guy, David Langford, he had some really good tools on how to work together. So I looked him up on the internet, called him, and a week later I had a voicemail waiting, and we chatted. It was a short conversation. I explained our issue, and he said, you know, I can help you with that, Jake, and I can show you a lot of other things as well. At the time, I wasn't really interested in any of those other things. I just wanted to stop all the yelling and the crying and meetings. So so we packed our bags and headed off to Montana, and this was the original team that went, and obviously learned some tools for how to improve collaboration and cooperation, but as you've seen here, learned a lot of other ways to engage kids and solve problems and save time. That was a big thing that stuck out to me. So I want to really address two big questions as we move throughout this presentation, which are, what does continuous improvement look like in an elementary school? And then what's this lens that Dr. Deming gives us to view our work, and why does it matter? And I'm going to talk about a system of profound knowledge. And yes, this is the third time you have heard about this today. So that means you only need 16 more times to hear about it before it sticks. OK, so we'll explore these questions by talking about the connection between reading logs and bad adult and child behavior. We'll talk about how this control chart helped change the culture in the building that I'm at now. I'll show you how this birthday card that I received from my staff signaled that another culture shift was happening. And then I'll show you how this confusing bunch of colorful arrows and boxes actually made things less confusing for one of our teams that was working on improving. So I want to start with a system of profound knowledge. And as you heard earlier, the system piece, appreciation for a system, is really just an understanding of that a system is a network of interdependent components that all work together to accomplish an aim. And hopefully there's an aim, otherwise Deming would say that you don't have a system. I've noticed two main philosophies around systems thinking in education. One is that this is my classroom, this is my system. I close the door on the captain of my own ship. I've heard it called silos, I've heard it called independent contracting, lots of things. The other one that I think Deming would approve more of is that looking at, these are all of our kids, and the work that I do as a kindergarten teacher or a first grade teacher or a specialist really impacts all of the kids at the school. Funny story, I have to be a little bit careful, I have some of my staff here. When I first came, my perception was, and some of the feedback that I was getting from some staff, was that we did have some of this going on, some silos. Everybody really enjoyed everybody else, but at the time, there was it wasn't necessarily a collaborative culture in the sense of we're really digging in, looking at what results we're producing, sharing strategies. Excuse me, I'm just getting over a cold. So a funny story about that. Last year, I was sitting with a staff member who was moving on to another school closer to where she lived, and we were just talking about the work we'd done together over the last couple of years, and she said, you know, Jake, I gotta tell you, I was really excited when you got hired here, and I liked you, and I wanted you to do well, and so when you started talking about people cooperating and collaborating, I was really worried that you weren't going to make it. But I'm still there. The second piece is an understanding of variation. I think I saw the quote in an earlier presentation. What is the variation trying to tell us? I think that's the key question that Dr. Deming asks. And he says that variation there will always be, whether it's in people, process, output. So wanted to take a look real quick at, this is the way our state displays data. They show it in three-year trends. That is an oxymoron, if anybody, for those that are into statistics. I can tell you what this doesn't tell us about our process. It doesn't tell us what happened before this year. It tells us that things got a little worse here. Tells us that things got a little bit better here, and that's about it. What I really prefer is to take a look at data over time. And yes, this is out of control. But this can tell a story, and we can learn from it. Now, I've heard this called a control chart, a run chart, a line graph. But one of my favorite names for it came from I was part of the Seattle Deming Users Group, and it came from this guy named Al, who's about 80. And he was a former aeronautical engineer for Boeing, and he just called it a learning chart. And I thought that was fantastic because that's what it's for. It's for learning. Next piece, theory of knowledge. And theory of knowledge is really just all about learning. In his book, The New Economics, Deming talks about Chanticleer, the rooster. And he says, you know, Chanticleer had this theory that he caused the sun to rise because every morning he crowed and the sun came up. Well, one morning he forgot to crow and the sun came up anyway, and now Chanticleer found himself with his theory in need of revision. And Deming says that, you know, without that theory, he would have had nothing to learn, nothing to revise. And he goes on to say that he says, without theory, your experience means nothing. And that there's no questions to ask, and that without theory, there's no learning. So I always think about, David's drilled it into my head, but you know, what's your theory? You know, what's your theory for having kids sit in rows, having kids sit in desks or in groups? What's your theory for giving kids rewards when they read? What's your theory for not doing that? So you gotta have a theory to learn. Final piece is psychology, which just helps us, as we've learned, understand the interaction between people and the systems that they're in, interactions between like students and teachers, administrators and teachers. So each one of these things is great by themselves, but I think the power comes in really understanding the connection between all of them, because they are a system, and that connection between all of them is the lens that Dr. Deming gives us to view the work we do, our systems, and ideally analyze whether or not they're getting us where we want to go. So to illustrate this, I wanted to tell a short story about reading logs. So for those of you, I know we have a lot of educators in the room, but just to review, reading log, some very key components. Always have to have a cute font. Clip art is essential, and I always prefer apples because everyone knows that teachers love apples. There's, you know, how many books, or the books you've read, how many minutes you read, and then the most important part is that parent's signature, because we know kids would never read unless their parents made them. The process goes something like this. You know, you have to read a certain number of minutes every night, and then your parents sign saying you did that, and then you bring that sheet back to school and you get something if you did it, and you don't get something if you didn't. So when I started asking kids about this and their experience with it, I heard some really interesting things. Heard one student say, I forged my mom's signature because I didn't want to get in trouble from the teacher. Heard another one say, I lied to my mom because I really wanted to go to Fun Friday recess. Heard one kid say something along the lines of, you know, I read, but I don't like recess, and I don't like my name up on the reading superstar wall, so I just didn't turn my sheet in. So what does that teacher think about that student? Last one was one of my favorites. A mom thought the idea of missing Fun Friday recess was kind of stupid, so she just signed it anyway, even if her child didn't read. So she was kind of in cahoots with her child, this bad behavior. So, you know, if we think about this through that lens of a system of profound knowledge, and we have a system, teachers managing that, there's kids, they're interacting with the teacher, you've got books, you have processes to manage it. There's a theory, maybe. Sometimes I've noticed is that we come into a new system and this is the way it's done, so we just keep doing it, and we don't necessarily have a theory about it, other than that's what they do, so that's what I do. But the theory really presumes that kids wouldn't read unless we did something to them to read. And so we also have variation, and interestingly, we have variation in output, so we're getting some kids reading no minutes, some kids reading a lot of minutes, some kids lying about the minutes, some parents lying about the minutes. But I think the interesting thing to think about, too, is we also have variation coming in. And so it's not just about the variation that our system is producing, but understanding the variation that's coming in. It also really impacts the psychology piece. So thinking about, you know, you have to start to ask kids, why didn't you read? They say, well, I had soccer practice. I had a church event. I was spending time. It was family night. Had multiple kids say things like, my dad doesn't live with us, and my mom works late, and I have to watch my four brothers and sisters in the house, sometimes multiple families living together in one house, and there's no quiet place to read. And so thinking about looking at that through that lens, you know, what impact are we having on kids by, you know, by managing this way? And then finally, obviously, the psychology piece. So it's creating dysfunction. It's making people lie about making parents lie, making kids lie. So the question really is, how do we design a system where kids might want to read and then trust them to do that? So think about what you just heard and any connections you might have, and take a second and talk about that at your table. Just let you know when it's coming up. All right, anybody care to share any connections, any thoughts? What connections or thoughts? Anybody? You don't have to.
Sure.
No, if you want to, yeah.
Okay, so really quick, Jake asked me about a reading at home program because I don't want to talk. And we spent a huge amount of time coaxing kids to read, prizes and stickers, and said, how many kids are reading? Not many. So what? And he says, so why are you doing it? Well, because kids have to read at home. I mean, really, that's my theory. They need to read, they'll be better.
So he finally showed me a video about intrinsic motivation and kids learning how to read, and I decided to shut down the reading at home program, quit giving stickers, quit giving prizes, quit sending books home, and kids were like, oh, okay. Well, after the first year, our scores didn't go any lower, right? So I thought, okay, he's on to something. So then I thought, well, how am I going to get the kids to read that want to read because they want to be a better reader, not because they're getting a sticker or a silly slinky or yo-yo that breaks in 10 minutes. And the kids, I said, if you want to read at home, I'll give you a packet. Well, do I get stickers? Nope. Do I get prizes? Nope. Okay, can I have my packet now, please? And those kids will still read at home. So it's less taxing on our system, and it was a huge learning for me as far as getting kids to read at home.
Thanks. Okay. So after 4 years of working as a title teacher, I decided to make the jump to fifth grade and was very excited about all these tools. I had just come off this first four-day conference. Very excited about all these tools I learned and applying them with kids, and I convinced one of my colleagues who's here to join me on this crazy journey, and I could summarize that first year with one word, which was an experiment. The results were mixed, but I think the thing we learned after that first year was, you know, I don't think we really knew where we were going or what we were doing. We had lots of resources, we had lots of ideas, but I think we were applying some of the tools without some theory. And so we had this idea that Deming talks about, one of his, or the fifth of his 14 points for management, this idea of continuous improvement. We felt like in order to do that, we needed to be able to visualize the work that we were doing, because teaching reading, teaching math, supporting kids with behavior, those are very complex things. And we just wanted to be able to see what that looked like so that we could go back and continue to revise. So I'm just going to run you through a real quick story of how we used a couple tools to be able to do that. And so we took a couple days, and we just said, what's everything that happens in a year with reading? And then broke it down and said, what's everything that happens in a year, or in a theme, and then in a lesson, what does a daily lesson look like? What does an assessment look like? And so we mapped all that out, turned it into some flowcharts, and this allowed us to be able to, this was our theory, basically, if we did these things, we would hope that kids would learn to read, enjoy reading, or do math, and it allowed us to do things like this, which was, once we realized that our theory was in need of revision, we revised it. So we would come back and sit down with these documents and look at, okay, this isn't getting us where we want to go. What aspects need to be changed, modified? So we would do that and then run through that process again each year. Very powerful to be able to visualize, especially when you're working with a group of people. Everybody kind of has, it's like everybody has kind of a different idea of what the system looks like, and they're looking at it from a different perspective. And so to be able to get something that captures the whole system in front of you, or that whole process, is very powerful and really speeds up the process of improvement. So I had gotten my principal credentials, but I decided to stay as a fifth grade teacher for a couple more years because I was having really a really great time. I was learning a lot. But then in 2013, I decided that I wanted to become a principal, and I did, and I started wearing green leisure suits and sweater vests. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. I've had that for a long time. So when I started as a principal, I was so excited because I felt like the work that I had learned as a fifth grade teacher, adults would love this stuff. I would be able to come in and, teachers would experience so much more joy and learning, and yeah, you know where this is going. Yeah. And so I started off that first year, and about 3 months into it, my superintendent called me and said, hey, Jake, the union survey just came in, the building climate survey. I just emailed it to you. Why don't you take a look at it? I said, okay. So I pulled it up and, you know, it was a survey, it's got bars and graphs and, you know, how people responded to things. And then in the very back, there was a section on comments where people could just write some things about how they were feeling. So I wanted to share a few of those with you. It gets better. This was related to the new evaluation system. I was fortunate enough to be a first-year principal the year that the state adopted a new evaluation system. This is a good one. Yeah. And then my personal favorite is long. I had to break it into three parts, but it starts here. Yes. I still have to take a few deep breaths every time I read this. You know, when you read something like this and you go into a job trying to, expecting that you're going to have people experience all this extra joy and learning, you really have to ask yourself some difficult questions because this person is not experiencing joy as a result of the way that I was managing. I think things did get better. Hopefully, one of my our first grade teachers is going to share a little bit. Hopefully, she says some things got a little bit better. But you know, I think things got better a couple ways. One, I think listening. You know, listening to people. What do they need? Listening to people you trust. Listening to people you don't trust, and just understanding how is what I'm doing impacting them and the work that they're doing. Second, not all negative feedback means that you should stop doing something. Not all positive feedback means you should keep doing something. But all feedback means you should pause and think about, okay, am I getting where I need to be? And how do I know? It's hard when you get feedback like this. You know, do I keep going? You know, I don't know. Learn, and then quality therapy with David Langford. He's available for a few phone calls, which is helpful. So a couple things that signified that there was some change happening in our building. We had a conversation in our building leadership team about this graph. When I first got to Gold Bar Elementary, I had taken all the data and put it into control charts, and I just wanted to see what does this system look like. And so last year we were trying to figure out what was going on with math in our building, and so we pulled this chart out and. Control chart, basically three standard deviations above and below the mean. You would expect in a stable system all the data would fit nicely between those two dotted lines. But we noticed that something was going on up here that we wanted to see what happened. Could we replicate that? So we started talking about it, and somebody asked the question, well, when did we adopt that new math curriculum? Somebody else said, oh, I think that was around 2000, 2001, something like that. And then they started counting. I watched them counting the dots. And they said, you know, that year is the first year that fourth graders received that curriculum and instruction since kindergarten. And so, you know, if you remember what I told you earlier, that we, to a certain extent, and not everybody, but to a certain extent, we were operating in silos. That was a significant conversation that we went back and shared with the whole staff about the power of working together and cooperating. Because the things that they said afterwards were, you know, we were all on the same page. We received lots of training. We were collaborating a lot. And so this chart really helped get that thinking back around alignment and acting like a system. And we actually continue, this chart comes out occasionally, and even if it doesn't come out, we refer to it and say, you know, hey, remember what happened when we were all on the same page? Our results, we saw, you know, that's special. So This birthday flowchart card that I received from staff signified that signaled to me that there was another culture shift going on. Previous to receiving this birthday card last year, I would kind of hear from people that staff were complaining about flowcharts, different tools or protocols that we were using, the amount of sticky notes that we were going through, and not really that into this, these ideas and the tools that we were using. And but when I got this birthday card, some other things were happening too. Staff were starting to make fun of me in meetings, and I felt like that was really positive because it was happening in front of me. There was a I felt like staff, you know, when you can joke about something, you know, you can tell people are softening to ideas, and so that was really important, and it was encouraging, and it made me feel good. So, thank you. I wanted to share a continuous improvement process that one of our teams has gone through. We have we call it the SAT, Student Assistance Team, but I know many schools have teams like that. Essentially, you have a student that's struggling either behaviorally or academically, and so you bring it up to this team, and the team helps you determine interventions or potentially look at special education referral. So in 2013, the process, some of the attributes, some of the meetings were, there was definitely some complaining that happened. Sometimes staff would bring somebody, they may or may not bring data. Conversations were, you know, I feel like this is happening, I feel like this student doesn't get this, I feel like they do this. At some point in the conversation, often what we would hear is, well, does special ed? Somebody else would say, yeah. And then, you know, we would make a referral. So the cool thing, though, was that the team was very dedicated. They felt frustrated with the process. Staff was frustrated. And they wanted to make things better. And so we felt like the first thing to do was to really capture what does the current process look like. So I'm going to run through some tools that I learned from David's Tool Time book and just talk about how they impacted the process that we went through. So obviously, you've heard me talk about flowcharts. So this was our initial capture of what that process looked like. I'll zoom in on here and some important things. The details aren't super important. But Deming says, if you can't describe what you're doing as a process, then you don't know what you're doing. Bill Schirkenbach, one of his colleagues, says in the first chapter of his book, The Road to Continual Improvement, I think it's called, he talks about one of the most difficult things that he had to do when he was working with organizations and consulting was trying to convince people that everything that they do is a process. Now, you can agree or disagree on, you know, on whether or not everything is a process and it could be described in a flow chart or, you know, a list. I don't think that really matters. I think that the point that they're trying to make is that if you have an opportunity to improve something and it's important enough, then you need a way to visualize the work that you're doing, especially when you're working with a group of people. You know, like I said earlier, everybody sees the problem a little bit differently, and if you can capture that in some form, you have an opportunity to improve it. So how many of you have been in a meeting where somebody gets you together and says, hey, we got this problem we need to solve? And so everybody comes in, you sit down at the meeting, and then it turns into complaining, and then somebody throws out a solution, hey, we should do this, and then somebody else says, no, that won't work because of this, and then because they're trying to, the meeting just kind of spirals out like that, and you've been sitting in it for an hour, and then all of a sudden, you're nowhere closer to solving the problem than you were before. Is that, I don't know, has that ever happened to anybody in here? So, I heard a good quote a few years back. I like to call those rocking chair meetings. Sometimes you can ask some of the staff that's here if I will set up a meeting and then they'll work by themselves. As I leave the room, I'll I'll draw a little rocking chair on the whiteboard. Just remember the rocking chair. So take a second and talk about your experience with meetings like that. All right, let's come back together. Anybody want to share out? It's your chance to complain. Okay. Yes. Right, yeah, people, did everybody hear that? She said, I'll let her say it. She'll say it better than I do.
Thank you. When I find myself in that situation, usually it's because people want to solve the problem, they don't know how to do it.
Yeah.
Thanks, David. I think we often, I don't disagree with you, but I think you need to listen to a complaint. Oftentimes we sideline people who have something to complain about, and then we do nothing about it, and the complaint just festers. And I think that some of the tools that David has provided are an opportunity to move from complaint to action. Then you're actually going to get some satisfaction, less complaining, and hopefully more buy-in when the next complaint comes up, because people are going to look for a tool to solve that complaint. A complaint is an unresolved problem. And I've seen many people being sidelined as continual complainers, but administrators or teachers who have heard it haven't been able to do anything about it because, one, they haven't had the tools, or they've simply washed their hands by saying, well, this person always complains.
Yeah, thank you. And I was going to say the same thing. I think that how do we capture those concerns in a meaningful way and do something with it? Because that's encouraging when that happens. That, we're at our table earlier, we were talking about it with kids, but it's the same. Kids are adults. You have these problems, concerns, and they can lead to real improvement. And so we need a way to capture that in a structured way so that we can do something with it. And exactly, I think those tools help. So as I mentioned, the team was wanting to improve. So over the next year, we continued to work on this process, and we came up with a new process, realized that there were multiple people involved, the teacher, the SAT, and then the child study team, which would be the special education referral team. And when we looked at these, one of the things that we noticed, they're not super dissimilar, but one of the big things we noticed was that in our initial process, the SAT meeting was just a step in that process. Whereas in the new process, we realized that that step really needed to be flowed out and understood, because that part of the process was either getting us closer to where we wanted to be or preventing us. And so not all processes have to be flowcharts. We just came up with an agenda that addressed all the issues that we were hearing within the team and outside of the team. So some of those were no follow-up meeting was scheduled. We didn't come out with an intervention. We didn't know what data to collect. There was no check-in happening between a member of the student assistance team and the person delivering the intervention to see how it's going and to support them. So we literally put every single one of those things that we were hearing into our agenda, timed it out, you know, are we able to fit all this into, you know, 8:10 to 8:47 a.m.? And felt like we could. Then we tried it. As we've continued to improve, we realized that the meeting is tight. And so we wanted to, in the spring, we asked, well, what are our, how can we continue to improve this process? So we used a couple tools. We used a force field analysis first, which is this one, the one on the left. And we just brainstormed what's driving us towards improvement and what's preventing that from happening. And that gets the complaints out in a structured way. The theory would be that if you're driving down the road and a tree falls in the road, you can step on the gas all you want and increase the drivers, but you're not getting anywhere until that log is moved. So you're going to get where you want to go faster by removing barriers. So we had a lot of barriers, so we needed to prioritize those. So we used a nominal group technique and rank ordered the issues as a team that we felt were the biggest. And we came up with ensuring the fidelity of the intervention was the top one. Well, that seemed very vague and difficult to tackle. So we wanted to learn some more. So we pulled out this confusing bunch of arrows and colors and boxes. And by the way, just a clarification, we ensure the fidelity of interventions. We don't insure them. We tried, but we were too high of a risk for the insurance companies. Humor to make fun of myself about a mistake in spelling. That works. The way this works is you ask yourself, is there a connection between one of these things and another? And then if there is, you would say, okay, which one's impacting the other the most? And then you would draw the arrow out of that one into the other one. And then you can see around the edges, there's that's just counting up the number that are going in, comma, the number going out. So the idea would be that if you want the most improvement, the most bang for your buck, you want to focus on something that has the most arrows going out. Because not only are you going to improve that, you're also going to improve or have a positive impact on all the other things that that's touching. So, interestingly, you can see that ensuring the fidelity of interventions, which was the top issue prioritized by the group, is not the top issue that this says we should work on. This says we should work on making sure that the clarity of the intervention is there first, as well as clarity around what data to collect. So we were right near the end of the school year, and this felt like a big piece to tackle, that clarity of interventions. And so we were looking for some low-lying fruit. So we used another tool called Potential Improvement Matrix. And we listed again all of those barriers, and we looked at what the impact would be and the doability of those. So high impact would be 10, low would be 1, very doable would be 10, very difficult would be a 1, and then implement the things that are high impact and easy to do. You know, very small things to do, not difficult. Everybody kind of had a project that they worked on over the summer, and we came back and shared those. But that still left the issue of that clarity because we were running out of time in the meetings. So we've tackled that in a couple ways. So what we've noticed is that when teachers come into an SAT meeting, they make a referral, they come in different levels of preparedness in terms of what they've tried, what data they're bringing in about what's working and what's not working. So we're seeing a great deal of variation in preparedness. So how does our understanding of variation impact the psychology of staff in this situation? So there's a couple ways we could approach it. We could get really frustrated that staff aren't coming in prepared, or we could get that for you. Or we could understand that if we work on the whole system, everybody's going to do better, thereby reducing the variation of the information that's coming in. So what we've done is put in some data systems and tools for teachers to or starting to do this, for teachers to collect similar data about their students, that they have assessment data that, because we have some system-wide assessments that we use, and then really defining what they need to do to prepare for that meeting. So, again, that how we react, you know, that lens gives us an opportunity to say, okay, do we go about this by trying to work on the individual? You know, is it a person problem, or do we have a system problem? And the variation, what is it telling us about the process? It's telling us that we have a system problem. So, 14th point, put everybody to work to accomplish the transformation. It's everybody's job. So this was taken just a couple weeks ago. We were going with that idea of what needs to happen leading up to the SAT meeting. So I gave the parameter from the beginning of the year until 8:10 in the morning of an SAT meeting. What does the teacher that made that referral need to do? And we sat around a table for 5 minutes, maybe, and we brainstormed all the possible things that would need to happen from the beginning of the year until 8:10 in the morning of the meeting. And then everybody plastered their sticky notes up on the whiteboard, and within about another 15 minutes, we had a flowchart. And so the next step, obviously, is to document this, and now this becomes our new theory, and we'll test that, you know, over the course of the year, our teachers coming in more prepared. So the cool thing about this is that we reduce variation in theory, I mean, that's our theory, but also we impact the psychology of teachers, because one of the things, some of the feedback that we got was that teachers felt anxious about bringing kids up to SAT because they felt like they were under the microscope. So if we're telling them, hey, this is how you be really prepared, and this is what it looks like to do a good job before you come into the SAT meeting, then we're hoping that that anxiety goes down and that teachers refer kids when they do when they really do need help, because the feedback we were also getting was that teachers are not referring students because they don't trust the process, because there's fear. So work on the system, not the person. All right, so wanted to show you in the words of a couple staff members that have been a part of this process, how things have impacted them. So I asked a couple people a couple questions. I asked, what has been your experience with continual improvement before the 13-14 school year, and then what has been your experience with it since then? And then a fun little question about flowcharts at the end. So,
helped us to move forward and kind of pinpoint our difficulties we were having. We seem to be kind of spinning our wheels and trying to make things happen. And I think in the team we felt frustrated that we just had the same difficulties each year, and they didn't really change.
Well, I had been on the team for multiple years, and we had always kind of struggled with the team being used as more of a jumping off point for special ed eval than for coming up with interventions. We weren't as good at following up on students once they were brought to the SAT, and if it wasn't going to be a special ed eval, we kind of didn't know where to go from there. So, I just felt like we weren't actually performing the purpose of the team, which was to try and help kids who were struggling sometimes and also help support teachers who were working with those kids.
I would say that most of my experiences with SAT-like teams have not been particularly satisfactory, because there really hasn't been a good effective process in place for managing the efficiency and the effectiveness of the teams.
So when we're trying to improve this whole process for the school, as a team, we have been noting where we need to make improvements in the process, and then coming up with ideas using a system of sticky notes or going around a table and each giving ideas, things like that. And then we kind of narrow down from there what is really doable and fixable at the moment, or if there's something we need to gather more information about before we can decide. And I think each time we do that, we get a little closer to having it run the way we want it to run, which is to make it useful for everyone and accomplish our goal, which is to help those kids who need it the most.
I think it's been really exciting for me to see, even after all these years that I've been in my job, to see where there are at least some places, sometimes it seems like little islands in the ocean, but there are some places where we are actually trying to put into place a process for examining something that is very important, and that is the SAT process in this case, put into place a process that looks at its effectiveness, looks at how efficient it can be, how it can eliminate redundancy. And I think in the year that I've been here, we've seen enormous improvements in how this process works at Gold Bar Elementary. I think one thing that was particularly striking is that we did not just put into place some plan at the beginning and then walk away. Even though that might have had some good processes getting to that, it wasn't left at that. We continued to identify problems in our individual SAT meetings, but also in broader SAT issues.
I think the team has been very excited, and we feel pretty empowered and proud of the system.
You got it going?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll read this one myself. I used to think blank about flowcharts, and now I think blank about flowcharts. I used to think somewhat positively about flowcharts. Now I think and dream about flowcharts.
I used to think flowcharts were very confusing, and I still think they're sometimes confusing, but I know I will be seeing a lot of them, and I'm getting used to reading them, and so they can, at some point, make things very clear how something is supposed to work. So, love flowcharts.
I used to think that flowcharts were way too much information, and now I think flowcharts help me to follow a plan. That's it.
Okay, so going back to those two big questions, what does continuous improvement look like in elementary education? I'm going to have one of our teachers share a little bit more about what that looks like, but I hope that's starting to get answered, and then that lens that Dr. Deming gives us to view our work and why it's so important. So I hope you're starting to get some insights about that. So if you will, please welcome up Phyllis Tubbs. She's a first grade teacher at our school. Oh, yeah, and we did that by looking at reading logs and how they cause bad behavior, looking at some of these tools. All right.
Okay. Well, I'm Phyllis Tubbs, and I have taught at Gold Bar for 14 years. This is my 15th year. And I wanted to start with a slide of Gold Bar Elementary because it's a really beautiful place, and it means a lot to me. I live in the community, both my kids went to this school, and I was pretty happy being there. And then we had Jake come and work for us. And his first year was filled with change. Now, none of those quotes that he showed were mine, because my quote was, Jake changes everything that's not nailed down, and some things that are nailed down. So his first year was really difficult. It seemed like every time we turned around, we were doing a new system or a new tool. But when I look back on that year, what I realize is there was so much change at once, I couldn't see any improvement. And that was Jake's first year. And then his second year, most of the staff came back, and two different things started to happen. One was seriously the rate of change slowed down, like I don't know what was left to change. And also, teachers started to use these tools but it was in this sort of an underground way. Like, no one really wanted to admit he was right. So someone would go to Jake with a problem, like they had some kind of a sticky part in their day, or they had a student whose behavior was disrupting the class, or they wanted to learn something more about like self-assessment. So you would go to Jake and talk to him in his office, and you would come back with a tool, like a flow chart, or some kind of data tracking system, or a capacity matrix. And people started to use these in their rooms, and they would be like, yeah, it worked. But no one was still ready to say, like, this guy's right. So there, that was kind of year two, was this underground using of the tools. And then in the spring, Jake invited us to go to, well, he opened up to the staff, to go to the 4-day quality learning seminar with David Langford in Texas. And I decided to go. I was one of the people who decided to go. I didn't really know what I was getting into. In fact, my sister asked me the day before, what are you doing? And I said, I don't know, it's my principal, it must be about data. So I went, not knowing what was happening. And seriously, within the first hour of the first day, I wrote Jake a sticky note and I said, oh my gosh, this is so amazing. Like, all this information suddenly started to make sense. About halfway through the first day, I wrote a second note to Jake and said, okay, I'm sorry. Now I understand what you were talking about. So I went through the full 4 days, and it really changed my teaching practice. I was so excited about putting in some different systems and trying out these things. But the problem was, it was June, and I didn't have a classroom. So I didn't have a classroom, but I did have an outdoor education program. My coworker, Tanya Christian, and I are starting a first grade outdoor education program. And Jake's like, yeah, go with it, that's great. But we had to organize everything. So what he suggested we use was this Gantt chart. So a Gantt chart helps you organize a big project, and I think we've seen some of these today. So we put this together at Starbucks, and here are all of our tasks that we had to do. And then up at the top, there's our timelines, and at the side over here, this is who's responsible for it. And so this was kind of our document to start this outdoor education program. And seriously, now when we have meetings, we pull out our Gantt chart, and we see how we're doing, and then we keep adding to it. So that was one thing that we used. And then we took our kids out. We're doing a program where the first graders are going out once a month to the woods, and we're doing some outdoor education. So we took our first trip in October, and it was great, and we wanted to see what the kids liked about it. So we came back, and we did a plus delta, and these are the things that the students enjoyed about our field trip. And then on the delta side, we said, well, what do you guys want to do differently next time? So we're using this information to plan for our next trip, which will be in a few weeks. And finally, back in September, my school year started. And one of the first things that we did was set up a code of cooperation. And so these are our norms, and I teach first grade. So these are our norms for our first graders. And we talked about, what do we want our room to feel like? How do we want to treat each other? And they came up with these guidelines for how we operate. And the very cool thing about this was, this week on Monday, I had a new student. And about halfway through the morning, one of our students came up to me and said, Mrs. Tubbs, we have not told Zach about the code of cooperation. And this is how meaningful it was to them. So we pulled everybody back in a circle. And I said, well, what is this code? And one of our kids said, this is all about us. We wrote this, and this is how we operate. Or they probably said how we behave. But it just made me realize how important the code of cooperation is with first graders. A second thing that I did, this was an operational definition. So about the second week of school, I said to my first graders, they were writing, I said, okay, you guys, go work quietly. And I noticed there was a whole lot of variation in what they meant. Some people were silent, some people were whispering, some people never stopped talking. So at first I was a little bit upset that they weren't listening to me, and then I really said to myself, we don't have an operational definition of working quietly. So I pulled my kids back and I said, this is what's going on. We don't all understand what it means to work quietly. So I had them write out their definition of what it meant. Now, it was the second week of first grade, so not everyone could write, but a few kids could, and I could write. So everyone got a sticky note, and with the help of either me or another student, they wrote down their definition. And it sort of, there were several different things that were said. They were, use whisper voices, don't talk very much, or be silent. So we took all of our sticky notes and put them in an affinity, like we gathered the ones that were similar. And then we put them on this hot dotting chart, and each student got one dot, they got to vote. And the one that the first graders thought was the best definition was be silent. So now when we work, I say, okay, you guys, we need to work quietly. And to them, that means be silent. They're not always silent, but at least we have that to refer back to. And I think I probably did say we need to have an operational definition. They got what they could out of it. This one's turned. Okay, so then we just hit.
Yeah.
So this is a flow chart that we have in our room. And
there's a flow chart here because once people don't know what to do, we use it so we know what to do. If you're not having breakfast, so you sign in your name, you hang up your jacket and your backpack, and then you do
reading.
And if you are having breakfast, you come in with your breakfast, you sign in your name, you put your jacket and backpack up, you sit down in the breakfast, and you read a book.
So this helps me out so much because in the morning the kids just can operate on their own. They can look at the flow chart if they can't remember what to do. We're about to make another flow chart because I think I get asked about 30 times a day, can I use the computer? And the answer is always yes, so I know they know the answer. We just need to have it laid out. So those are some of the things that are happening in my classroom as a result of learning about quality learning and changing some of the practices. I feel like our staff as a whole is changing as well. I know Melissa does a lot of cool things in her room, and some other teachers are doing that as well. A couple things I wanted to just share quickly that I've noticed as a building, like bringing in these tools, they are really starting to allow for shared leadership and for everyone having a voice. We had to, maybe a month or so ago, we had a staff meeting where we had to come up with our school improvement plan, which all schools have to do. And usually it's a lot of drudgery and people don't really know what's going on. And we had a similar prompt to the flow chart. At our meetings, we all stand in a circle and respond to prompts and listen to each other. And the prompt was, I used to think this about school learning improvement plans, and now I think this. And because of the process that we used with the building leadership team of getting information from other people, brainstorming, trying to implement a lot of change, so many experienced teachers said, I used to think a school improvement plan was just something that happened, and now I feel like I have a voice in it. And that was said by three or four people, and I was excited by that. So those are some of the things that are happening in our school. What's that? Oh, should I do the last one? Okay. This last one I'll show you too. This one. All right, this is our loss function diagram. And this came about because we had decided as a staff to do a new reading assessment, which is called the DRA. And it's basically like a running record where you have to meet with each kid for 10 minutes. It takes about 10 minutes by themselves. We had decided as a staff to do this in the spring. And then this fall, we implemented this process. But because it was an assessment, we had to come up with a testing window. So we did this process where everyone was given three sticky notes. And one of them, we had to come up with a testing window, like how long is this test going to take? One of them, you have to answer what would be your ideal length of time. And the second one would be what would be too long of a length of time. And the third one would be what's too short of a length of time. So they get compiled in this manner that shows you which timeline will give, like basically make the least amount of people unhappy. So we came up with, I think, 15. We came up with 15 days. And we went out to our classrooms to go administer this test because we'd all agreed upon this testing window. And we realized that most of us knew nothing about this test. So even though we'd done this great group process to come up with 15 days, it wasn't working. It was way too slow. So then I was talking to Tamara on our staff, and she said, we need to revisit this. Like, we need to bring in the loss function again and figure out a new testing window. So we went back to the staff. Is there a second? As a staff, we went back and we went through the same process again of saying your ideal amount of time, what would be too little and what would be too much. And we came up with, I think we had to start again with 15 days. And the exciting thing to me was not so much that we were doing this testing, but that people on our staff were starting to be involved in the leadership, suggesting using these tools to make decisions that involve giving everyone a voice. So I feel like at Gold Bar, we're at the beginning of really making some good changes.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if we have time for, we have time for two questions, apparently. We did that good of a job. Yes?
Did you change letter grading when you got hired?
Did I change letter grading when I got hired?
Yes.
That was the only thing I didn't change. No. We didn't. That's probably a long conversation, though. Yeah?
I just noticed in the presentation that the training came, what, year two? Mm-hmm. Three? Yeah. Do you think things would have gone better if you had the training up front?
Hard to say. I mean, I don't know that it would have been readiness. That, well, yeah, you can ask them. Yeah.
Sharing this information with us, but we weren't ready to hear it. And so I think it was, in a way, a good, it was a few rough years, but it was good to wait, I think.
We needed the experience.
Yeah, we needed, yeah.
We needed money, too.
That was an expensive conference.
Do we have time for one more? No. Okay, that's it.
Just,
yeah, you can ask me later.
All right, guys, it's about...